Welcome to this launch of the East Asia Forum Quarterly, this time titled Asia on the Edge, or On the Edge in Asia. Often in our work on East Asia Forum, we have a focus on the big powers, the big players in the region, China, India, Indonesia, Japan, Korea. This time round in East Asia Forum Quarterly, we're very much focused on the smaller powers in the region, but the influential, increasingly influential powers in the region, like Mongolia, Myanmar, and the countries of mainland Southeast Asia, Bangladesh, Sri Lanka in South Asia, and so on. And this issue of East Asia Forum Quarterly, which is hot off the press this morning, features a review of developments in these countries and the way in which they're playing into regional affairs in an increasingly important way. And no more country more so than Mongolia. So it's a very great pleasure for me to welcome the Foreign Minister of Mongolia on this auspicious occasion, not only to the ANU, but especially to this school in the College of Asia and the Pacific, where so many of Mongolia's, mainly sons actually, brightest and best sons and daughters have received graduate training. It's a great thing to have you with us, Minister Bol, and it's a very timely visit in terms of the interest in the development of Mongolia's place in the region, in the world, and the relationship between Mongolia and Australia. There is perhaps no more typical country on the edge than Mongolia, surrounded as it is by its large neighbours, especially China and Russia, having to deal with them over thousands of years of history, and in new circumstances having to deal with a China that's resurgent in terms of its economic power and therefore its political power, in a way that many of us in other parts of the world are also having to deal. And it's of particular interest to have you share your thoughts with us about these issues today. The Minister is a member of Parliament, the Assembly, in Mongolia. He's had a fascinating and distinguished career in Mongolia's modern development. He was educated in Germany, in East Germany as it then was, in the late 1970s, early 1980s, where he studied social sciences and political economy and philosophy and Marxism, I'm sure. Subsequently, of course, returned to Mongolia and has played a critical role in the movement towards Mongolia's democratisation. He's currently in the Assembly as a member of the Democrat Party, the governing party of Mongolia, and as Foreign Minister, but he's also served in other roles in ministries in Mongolia, including as Mongolia's Defence Minister. Welcome today. We'll have the Minister make a presentation, and then he's kindly agreed to join us in conversation with a small panel that will include experts coming from various dimensions of the issue Asia on the Edge in conversation after he makes his presentation. Please welcome the Foreign Minister of Mongolia, Mr. Bol.
Thank you for your interest, and of course it is a great honor for me, a special honor, especially this trip and this visit, which happens after 21 years, when first time when Mongolia and Australia discovered each other, the Mongolian Foreign Minister is visiting again. But this is not saying that our relations are so loose, you know, because Australia and Mongolia has found each other as real partners, as real close allies. Therefore, This visit only confirms, upgrades our relations. And here to be here at the university in Canberra, it is a great honor. And to be in the panel with those distinguished professors, it's a real challenge for me. You know? But I'll try to elaborate a little bit on the issues as it was mentioned by Professor, and explain the today's situation in Mongolia. You all may have heard that Mongolia has a real great history. I think all the great nations in Asia would envy us, and would envy at least our history, you know, which created the largest empire in world history, you know, which made possible that those big countries in the world were established, countries ruled by Mongolians like Russia, China, or India, or in the countries also in the Asian, different parts of Asia like Afghanistan, Iran, and others. And this all made Mongolia a true country which understands all the melting of civilizations and understandings of the human history, which makes us have this special position. Country of 3 million people, having 1.5 million square kilometers of land, and existing peacefully and prospering between these two giant countries. One is in territory, the biggest country, Russia, and the one is in population, the biggest country in the world, China. And having also very good relations to all other countries. Having ruled the world, it's peculiar that Mongolia is maybe the only country in the world which has no enemies now. We are friends with every country in the world, with both Koreas, with Palestine, with Israel, name any country, we are friends. You know? Therefore, it makes us a real special position to contribute to the regional affairs, to the world affairs, to make sure that in this world, size is not the number one issue. You know? It is the active involvement, it is the imagination, and it is the feeling and understanding which makes countries work efficient. And this is an approach we always put on our agenda, not only in the internal politics, but also in the international politics. 1990, just a few years after I graduated from East German University, going through this very hard, harsh life in a communist society, growing up in a scholar's family who was for some time also a dissident, giving us the ideas that there should be change, you know, and this system cannot succeed where you collect and own everything and then distribute the wealth, trying to create an equal life. And this was also main reason that many young people, like myself, that went to the central square and expressed our firm position. We want change. We want freedoms. We want the world open to Mongolia. And if you can imagine, Mongolia after 70 years of communism, and really caught in that system, over one night was a free country. Of course, over one night it was bankrupt. There was nothing to eat, nothing to sell, but we overcome. That time maybe our per capita income was less than $200. But today, in this short period of time, we made it to a middle-income country. We made it to a real democratic institutions working country. And this is something, you know, everyone still very curious. And how did Mongolian people accomplish that? And that is also many countries in the region are asking and want us to share the process we have gone through. And I think that's also because of the nature of Mongolians. Because we are a nomad society, a nomadic, which means every person is responsible for its own fate, own life, own land, own family, and has on the one boss, which is the eternal heaven, which made possible that we took responsibility, we changed the country, we created the institutions, and we opened the economy, and which we see today. You know, it is really essential that giving freedom to people is a most essential thing to have a stable economy for the future. Of course, there has been, because Mongolia is very abundant in natural resources, we rely a lot on the commodity prices. And there has been times it was up, it was down. But the general direction has always been in the right path. Because 1990, it was 100% state-owned economy. But since then, it was nearly 80% private sector until now, and that will even continue. And also our today's, after having these backlashes, attracting investment and discouraging it, you know, up and downs, we developed the government consensus, the country's consensus. We should not give up those freedoms, those benefits we share thanks to the democratic and new rule. Therefore, our recent legislation, which encourages the investment, again showed as open and democratic country, we don't hide our mistake. We say, yes, we made mistakes, but we repaired them. We changed our position. And we made another step, we make a more stable environment for future. And also, we addressed, again, seeing from the perspective of investors, of the business people, who carry the country, who carry the economy, how they would feel, how they would see Mongolian government to make better environment for them. And this policy, as we call it, this Mongolian government should be a smart government, and a smart government policy is designed for this. And maybe later at the panel, we could elaborate a little bit on that. But I think, because of the time constraint, I just wanted to give some very brief hints, you know, how you can see Mongolia as a democracy, as a country, as an active member in the region, where Australia and Mongolia really share the same values. You know. It was a real big risk in the beginning, where there was no example in other Asian or other countries in the region where an Asian society, Asian country could start at the same time the political reforms and economic reforms. It was always said, you know, the Asian way is first bring up the economy and then we can start moving with the political reforms. But because we are always in hurry, you know, because we are the horse raiders, you know. And we created the first internet, you know, through this postal system on horse, you know. Therefore, also this new level of life, we wanted to have it more quicker, you know. Therefore, we really tried hard, designed a new constitution, and from that time, you know, in these 2 decades, you know, those who have visit Mongolia before the 90s and then present days, you would really see it is a different world, you know, it is different. And I think, of course, we accomplished a lot, and any other person's life, it would be really inimaginable, you know, what we have accomplished. Of course, today there are issues, there are bad press, but we will go through, you know, because they were saying that, because generally you all, as students and researchers and professors, you all have read a lot of books about Mongolia. Generally, in the past, there was more wrong understanding about Genghis Khan, you know. And then our saying was, actually, Genghis Khan was a good person, only had a bad press, you know. But today, we hope, sometimes we have a bad press, but generally we are a very good country, you know? And we are very good people, you know? And you all are welcome to Mongolia, and we can really do a lot together and make the difference. Thank you very much.
Well, thank you very much, Minister, for what was unquestionably a refreshing view of Mongolia and our interests in Mongolia, and a view that expressed a sense of excitement about Mongolia's potential and the interests we have together in working with you to realise that potential. Let me introduce the panel to you. Most of you will know them, I think, but Dr. Haiwal Che is head of the Korean Studies Centre here at the ANU, immediately on my right. Dr. Lee Narangoa is head of the new Mongolian Studies Centre at the ANU, but we know her also as a deep specialist in Japanese studies, literature and Japanese affairs here at the ANU, and has made a big contribution to our study of Asia in that dimension, as well as her constant and steadfast representation of Mongolian interests in Australia. And at the very end is Professor Hugh White, who, as you know, is Professor of Strategic Studies here at the ANU. Minister, if I can say something a little about the potential that Mongolia has realised already since 1990, and the changes came, as you said, overnight to Mongolia. It wasn't an easy call to get things roughly right, as you said, roughly pointed in the right direction, but you have done so spectacularly, because your economy now is growing at one of the highest rates of growth of any economy in the world. I think it was 12% plus last year, and it's looked like it's growing at a similar sort of rate this year. That has to do in part with the same sort of things that have been affecting Australia's growth rate in recent years, because like us, as you described, your richly endowed economy in respect of resources, and the resource boom has driven that growth. But it doesn't happen automatically, even if you've got a lot of resources and you've got it right somehow. I wonder if you'd like to sort of say, first of all, a little bit about why you think you've got the commodities boom right in recent years, and why you've actually achieved, on the back of the commodities boom, such a strong rate of economic growth. And we'll talk more, I think, about its impact in a moment. Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Yes. Because, you can consider Mongolia as one of 10 top 10 countries with regard to mineral reserves in commercially viable terms. And recent years, of course, lack of domestic investment resources, we opened the economy, especially the commodity sector, for broad foreign investment. And this was also the main reason that so many foreign companies get into Mongolian market in the resource. Especially also among leaders, the Australian companies, they are the top in investment, top in numbers. More than 200 companies entered Mongolian market, and also top in number of professionals working in Mongolia. More than 700 present. You know, it's a really very high number to considered in Mongolia. And this all enabled our economy growing always in double-digit numbers in recent years. And we see, because now those big projects are in place, that will even continue the next even decade or two. And also, our Mongolian government is committed to ensure that that this long-term investment is protected and the investors can get and enjoy the real stability for their activities in Mongolia. And even last year, it was a globally very difficult year because of economic crisis. And the growth we anticipated was about 20%, but still, it was a bad year. We had 12.5, you know. But we will make things better. We will make sure that the trend goes back again. We will have higher growth rates for coming years. And also the legislations we issued is all designed to make this happen. And especially we have a lot of advantages with respect to the resources, because can you imagine that when I was chairing the Minerals and Petroleum Authority and I was traveling around and showing the Mongolian economics to develop a mining project, and I thought people were shocked when a single project approximately it needed 1.5 years to recover all the investment, you know. And there has been deposits and mining projects where really it's just you mine it at no cost, really, you know. And that was a very good advantage. And also in the foreseeable future, of course, now we are going after the real huge world-class projects where, of course, it will need those costs, but it will need also those negotiations, because here we are already now talking about projects which will last at least 50 years. You know? Therefore, you all know this now present these discussions around, for example, Oyu Tolgoi mine with the Rio Tinto and other companies, where it is really a decision which is changing the history of Mongolia. Therefore, of course, it has taken maybe longer time as the investors would like and as we would like, but I think at the very end, everyone realizes that, that Mongolia's people, the Mongolia's government, really pro-investment, pro-development, and pro-cooperation. And I really have no doubt that this pace of growth will continue. And therefore, I would like you all to share this message to all your countrymen and support us.
Well, certainly you've clearly got a number of things right, and going forward you're optimistic about how to maintain the momentum of growth and development through the next decades or so. I mean, Nara, you're somebody who's actually been to Mongolia, you've lived in Mongolia. Most of us haven't been to Mongolia, although we're all going now that we've had Minister Bol's visit here. Looking on the ground in Mongolia at how this change, this tremendous revolution in Mongolia's circumstance has been affected over the last few decades, how does it look on the ground to people in Mongolia? Do the benefits flow through, and do people worry about capturing the benefits from this growth in Mongolia, as we do sometimes here in Australia from a minerals boom like the minerals boom we've had?
Oh, yes, there are a lot of change. When I first visited Mongolia, it was about 15 years ago, and it then Mongolia was sort of still in the transition, but we can see the changes started happening. So for example, when you want to go to a restaurant, say, in Ulaanbaatar, and there were quite a few restaurants, Western restaurants and so forth, but what we, I heard from the locals were, oh, you see, if you had come here 10 years ago, we didn't have anything like this. You know, and if the foreigners come to who come to Mongolia, then they had to just eat balls or meat, anything else. So we hardly had veggies, and they had always problems with that. Yeah, that kind of thing is really in ground level. And then the other thing is sort of you know, I talked to the locals during that time was that. One of the most important things was the welfare issues. You know, communism was bad, and especially in terms of ideology and economy and so forth. But one of the good thing with communism was that you know, the welfare system was so good. Everybody was poor, but you know, it was taken care of. Education and health system, you know, which is really which are most important thing for you know common people. And they were worried about that. So, and they said after the collapse of communism, you know, overnight everything has changed, but we don't have the NECTL, which was the community system, which had, you know, had been helping the people, it's gone, and we are completely left, you know, by ourselves, and then we have to look for our own way of educating our own children, and then it's getting expensive, and then we don't have a really good welfare system. So since then, it has been changing, and then there is, you know, Medicare system and so forth in place. So my question to the minister is actually that, you know, we know in Western media a lot of things talking about investment, trade, and mining boom, and so forth, yeah. But we don't hear very often about the domestic issues and social issues. And my question to you is that, you know, how the welfare system, especially healthcare system, is going at the moment.
Yeah, I should say, after the reforms happened in Mongolia, we tried until now two things, you know, to preserve the education system, that every child gets formal educations, and also to try to support the healthcare system. Of course, adding the, all the market economic components to the existing one. But this is, of course, a very big issue, you know. And right now, after bringing the economy in a new stage, now we are really seriously dealing with the reforms in healthcare and education, where we want to see more related to our new realities, its system, which is really sound. And I think that will, of course, take some time, but in our parties, because we are more the conservative type of party, it is really set up that we will go for the really the more market-driven reforms in that sector, but keeping in mind that also those vulnerable groups would be supported with it, as a targeted support, you know. And that is a general idea about the reform. But at the same time, of course, recent years, there has been a lot of discussion, not only here, everywhere, also in Mongolia. So there is a lot of wealth, there is a lot of money coming out of mining. So how the ordinary people can benefit. And we went through all the different stages, you know, all the different systems which were tried in the world. Even in the past years, we distributed cash to every citizen, you know, some mining income. And then, of course, we realized that was not so good idea. But, but you better do the mistakes, then you never repeat it. It's important not to repeat, but to do the mistake is okay, it's human. No? But now we are really trying to make a competitive economy and support the targeted groups and make sure that generally the economic system is working toward growth and toward diversification and toward the sustainable development. This is what we have, what we always keep in mind.
You mentioned implicitly rather than explicitly, because you're too modest to mention it explicitly in your presentation, Mongolia's diplomatic strategy, which has been labelled, I think, a third neighbour strategy. Sitting cheek by jowl with Russia and China there, as you described it, presents its difficulties from time to time, but also its big opportunities. I wonder, Hugh, how this strategy is evaluated outside Mongolia. I mean, the minister has a vested interest in it, but what do you think of it coming from outside Mongolia? He's a hard-headed analyst of these things.
Well, it's a fascinating question, and I'm really glad to have a chance to be part of the panel. You know, transport's so cheap these days that economists have almost forgotten about geography. But we old-fashioned strategists still think about it a great deal. And when you look at Mongolia and look at Australia, look at two countries which, despite some similarities, could not have a more different diplomatic and strategic geography. I mean, we're both big, empty, dry, and rich in minerals. But apart from that, almost everything's different. In particular, you know, we're maritime and recent. Mongolia is utterly continental and old. All our neighbours, except for one, are small and weak. Both of Mongolia's neighbours are huge and very powerful. And that gives Mongolia a completely different kind of foreign policy and strategic policy challenge. It seems to me that that also makes Mongolia's foreign policy one of the most interesting in Asia and one of the most successful. The challenge, of course, is stark. That is, how do you manage, first of all, how do you manage those two huge relationships with those two huge neighbours? But it's a particular challenge, something for Australians to think about, because Mongolia also does it without being part of any obvious overarching grouping. For us, you know, we approach the whole question of our foreign policy through the framework of being a US ally. If you're Indonesia or Singapore or Thailand, you approach the whole question of foreign policy through the idea of being part of ASEAN. If you're European, it's part of being the EU. Mongolia is part of lots of things, but none of them define its international identity as much. And of course, on top of that, it has an immensely complex history, including having invaded at various stages those huge neighbours. It's got a lot of assets, including, of course, those extraordinary economic assets. It's also got the political asset, which the minister touched on. And that is, and I don't think being a democracy is always an asset strategically or diplomatically, but I think in Mongolia's case, in the last 20 years, it has been. It's helped it to manage this immensely difficult thing. But success requires, of course, that the great powers themselves, in that case China and Russia, don't get on too well. Otherwise, they could gang up on Mongolia. But they don't get on too badly. Otherwise, they'll be both willing to irritate the other by trying to intrude into Mongolia and eat it up. So you want the great powers not to get on too well, but not to get on too badly. Your own relationship as the sort of, you know, third power in that system is you want to have good relations with both of them, but not too good with both of them. And you've got to be prepared to stand up to them. And one of the most interesting things about Mongolia's recent diplomatic history is the way in which, I'm sorry, I'm a strategist, so I mentioned disputes, but Mongolia's had disputes with Russia, for example, over the management of its railways, in which it's been very firm. It's had disputes with China in which over the management of its coal reserves, in which it's been very firm. It's been prepared to push back pretty hard at both of them. So it doesn't manage the relationships just by being nice. But also, as Peter mentioned, it managed this thing by reaching out past those two neighbours to, I think you use the phrase, the virtual third neighbour, that is the whole of the rest of the world. And the other really interesting thing about Mongolia's foreign policy is how broadly based that's been. We're talking over lunch, the minister, Mongolia is part of the OSCE. The E in OSCE is Europe, by the way. It's part of all sorts of connections which one wouldn't automatically think. And I do think that reaching out to a whole range of different countries building a very complex set of interconnections, including for institutions like the UN. Mongolia must be, haven't looked this up, but must be the biggest per capita contributor to UN peacekeeping forces in the world, I would guess. So all sorts of connections have been built up there. But this requires a lot of agility, it requires a lot of nerve, and it requires a fair bit of charm, and I think we've seen a little bit of that today. I mean, for example, China obviously has... Mongolia obviously has formidably good relations with China. It also has extremely good relations with Japan. Now, Tony Abbott could take a leaf out of this book. But behind the joke, there's a very serious point. That is, this kind of agility in managing a very complex set of relationships between the set of powers is actually something that Australia doesn't have and it needs. That's why I think Mongolia's got one of the most interesting as well as the most successful foreign policies going. But there's a very interesting set of questions emerges from that, if that's a fair analysis of where you're coming from. Because a couple of things might make it harder for you. One, of course, is that China might become too strong. And do you worry that as China keeps on growing, if that's what it's going to do, it's going to become harder and harder to kind of keep that balance? We worry about that in Australia, certainly. Not with the same geographic imperative, but economically, we're right up there. And the other, of course, is do you worry that that Russia becomes too assertive, will I use that word? And, this is this week being what it is. Does a neighbour of Russia at the other end of the old empire feel anxious when you see what's happening in the Ukraine?
Yeah, I think...
This is off the record. Yeah.
These days, all questions end up in Ukraine. But I think Australians would understand Mongolia very well because there are so many similarities. As we arrive here and see and meet the people, they are all so open and so friendly and so understandable. I really understood why Australia is now one of the top three countries where Mongolian young people want to study, where we already have more than 600 students, and the government scholarship only a few of them, It means that mainly privately they are coming. And what you have, you are not an island, you are a big country, but surrounded only by water. Also, we are a continent, surrounded only by land. And the challenges we have, really, it's something we have always to deal, and it's not a century, it is over millennia we were dealing, and that's our natural waters, Therefore, I think anything happen, but at the end you will see Mongolia win, You see, Mongolia has been under foreign dominance twice. One, it was the Manchu Empire. More than 200 years. Where is the Manchu Empire today? Mongolia, win. We were 70 years under communist, under Soviet bloc. Where is Soviet Union today? Mongolia, win. Therefore, I think we will manage,
So I should have added confidence to that list of
evidence. It comes from riding a horse.
Right. You see, we're nomads too. That's the thing we have.
One of the interesting aspects of third neighbour diplomacy, important aspects of it, is the relationship with Korea.
Yes.
And what's between South Korea and Mongolia, which is North Korea. You've played an active role in recent times. Your president and you yourself have played an active role in Korean Peninsula diplomacy. Looking at it from South Korea's perspective, how do you see the value of Mongolian play into the Korean Peninsula? Positive or negative?
Well, Minister actually mentioned that Genghis Khan. So Genghis Khan is a good person with a bad publicity. So there is actually a long history between Mongolia and Korea, yeah, with periods of enmity or sometimes hostility. But the Mongolian invasion of Korea in the 13th century and the subsequent century of subordination are probably the most well-known historical link to Mongolia. But interestingly enough, there is a very popular drama playing on South Korean television right now based on the true story of the actual historical figure of Lady Ki. She was a Korean woman who was sent to the Yuan dynasty, where she served as a lady-in-waiting and became empress as the 14th woman for the first time in UN history. So it's really interesting, the timing of this drama at a time when there is a just remarkable surge of trading volume and cultural exchange between Mongolia and Korea, South Korea in this case. So a growing number of South Koreans have begun to settle in Mongolia for business. And at the same time, a significant number of Mongolians have migrated to South Korea for work and education. So I think this trend will is likely to continue and possibly foster new kinds of interactions between Mongolia and Korea, for that matter. And I think historical memory and the kind of media representation as shown in TV drama kind of thing, possibly film as well, will play a very important role in shaping the relationship between Mongolia and Korea, especially in the area of soft power. But in the area of political arena here, Mongolia is one of the few countries to maintain very friendly relationship with both North and South Korea. Last October, the Mongolian president visited North Korea, the very first state head after Kim Jong-un come to power. I think such a visit really indicates that Mongolia is a very important country to North Korea. And when he was visiting North Korea, he gave a public lecture at Kim Il-sung University. In that lecture, he emphasized freedom, human rights, and open society. And I think I'd like to note that the video of his lecture is available online, but the follow-up Q&A session is not. So I'm really curious about the reaction of the audience to that speech. And also, generally speaking, if you could share with us what were the kind of outcome of that state visit. Secondly, given the close ties between Mongolia and North Korea, we'd like to hear more about what you feel are the future prospects of Mongolia playing a role in mediating or advancing relationship between North and South Korea. What would be the advantage or disadvantage of a unified Korea for Mongolia? Can you imagine circumstances in which Mongolia might be prepared to play or participate in the reunification process? And if so, what would be or what is the role of the Mongolia in the process?
Well, thank you.
Quick answer.
Yeah, I'll try to be quick. Yeah, I was at the Kim Il-sung University when our president held this lecture, and one more issue he also touched was no death penalty. No?
That's right.
Because the very first move of our president was he set a moratorium on death penalty, to set the example for the region. Because going through the communist regime, we really understood, you know, it is important to keep people alive. You know? Therefore, I think that was a very, very important message. But at that time, the North Korean leader didn't meet our president. Suddenly, it was unavailable, but we made many data theories, but later we understood, you know, the issue. Exactly at that time, it was the issue of the Chanson Tech, is his another very powerful person who was, you know, all the. I think it's really very. It was a really very important visit. I think maybe a turning point for international community to understand. Yeah, I was. It was my second, after 10 years, you know. And 10 years ago, yeah, the society was very equal. It was a different world there. And we really saw no changes, you know, which would be held possible. But today, you see a totally different picture. It is people using mobile phones. So it means already the new communications there. There is a middle class. And there is a differentiation in society. And most important, the people, ordinary people's faces in the streets, they are unhappy, you know, which is the most important indicator, you know, that the time is ticking. You know. Therefore, I think we speaking to everyone and saying, now it's time also from our side, you know, to take the chance. We can have different judgments, but there is new leadership, there is a new level of development in societal environment, and we should take this chance, you know. And here, Mongolia could play really an important role, you know, because as Professor mentioned, between Mongolian and Korean people, there is a very special relationship, not only because our language is one family, not only because we have a common history, but we have a real special sympathy. Therefore, when after the democratic revolutions in all the East European countries, every country in Eastern Europe, which became a capitalist country, was declared an enemy country. You know? But we came through the same process, but Mongolia was never declared an enemy country. You know? Okay. They're still considering as a brother country or brother economy, I don't know. And this means that still Mongolia can be a leverage to make closer both Koreas, to make soft landing for North Korea for future. But only, of course, if we are asked for, you know, if there is a need, Mongolia's involvement for the region, you know, because also our chances, you know, any other country in the region, they have some special national interest regarding North Korea, you know. Mm-hmm. But in Mongolia, there is no special national interest, you know. Therefore, we can really be a very important platform if it need be, you know. Therefore, it is up to professors and scholars like you, you know, to elaborate on that, you know, and make sure that your politicians hear your voice and make their observations. You know.
I want to open this up to questions from the floor. We've got microphones here somewhere. You got microphones?
They're in the back.
But before I do, I come back to the question of managing the China relationship and taking advantage of your opportunity now and down the track. Obviously, there's a big interest in China investment in the resource base in Mongolia, and you mentioned openness to investment, the importance of that to your success. Do you have a special attitude towards Chinese investment in Mongolia, or are you open to Chinese investment? We're struggling with some aspects of this in Australia, but basically, I guess we've sort of held the line and kept a pretty open approach to Chinese investment in Australia, despite one or two wobbles. How do you confront that issue in Mongolia?
Yeah, I think that's a very important issue. It was also mentioned previously, because 10 years ago we had a totally different attitude. Mongolia's economy was very small, and any investment from any one country would really dominate and make the things long-term difficult. But in only 10 years, our economy grown 10 times, and that Chinese investment was important, but not prevailing. And but now we came in the mature stage where we can really accommodate a larger scale project and larger investment. And of course, there has been discussions, to restrict or to enable. And we We are going for the way where we're enabling. And this means, yes, now there will be a multi-billion Chinese investment in our economy. But now our policy is now to balance it, attracting more investment from third neighbor countries. Not diminishing the Chinese investment, but enabling even more investment. You know? And this is something where, therefore also my visit here, you know, I started talking to Australian business community yesterday in Melbourne and tomorrow also in Sydney. This is something where I want to reach out, and it's also a very important opportunity for them, you know, for Australian business or any other country's business. Because of this big Chinese investment, there are so many opportunities. You know? Imagine only one project with Rio Tinto had created so many business opportunities. But now those big projects targeted in mining, infrastructure, and energy, and everywhere, this will really make a big difference. You know? Therefore, we now set as our priority to be part of the Asia-Pacific economic cooperation, you know, which is really, 10 years ago, it was too early, but now it's the right time. You know?
I might come back and ask about the Australian investors later on, but if I have time, but let's take some questions from the audience. Yes, first here and then here. Could we have the microphone down here and run over here? First, in the middle.
Thank you. Brian Martin from the ANU. This is to the Foreign Minister. It's just a follow-up from Hugh White's question, and that is about the Mongolia's foreign policy. Given that there seems to be a developing strategic synergy between Russia and China, and given what we have all been talking about, the Ukraine situation and a possible hardening of relations between the West and Russia in the foreseeable future, how will this impinge on your balancing act between the two great powers? And also, given the fact that neither of these powers are democracies, how does a small country that is a democracy ensure its integrity in a deepening situation where the options of balancing might become more restricted?
Okay, with regard to the balancing, we experienced in the past, you know, when we dominated the relation with one neighbor and then another neighbor. And recent more than 20 years, we really tried to develop a system where we can set as priority to develop balanced and very sound relation with both neighbors. And I think in that we're still succeeding. But one of issues is very related to the political system, you know. And here, maybe in the beginning, there was a difficulty when Mongolia's new system could be seen as a not so comfortable solution, you know, because when our democratic revolution happened, it was just half a year after the Tiananmen Square events, you know, and also the events in Russia over the period of time after this, you know, this showed, you know, that the leaderships of these both countries now realize that in case of Mongolia, it is a really necessity that we have a broad people's participation in government decisions. And I think that now that's understood, and in every interaction with our neighbors now, they're always expressing that there is a full understanding and full acceptance of the democratic system in Mongolia. And I think that would even make possible that we will have even more broader relations. And also adding to that, also they fully understand also our desire to develop the third neighbor policy where on our part we can choose based on common interest and common values. Therefore, I think that Mongolia-Australia relations would only benefit if our keeping balance with our neighbors, the relations, is successful.
Suiwala, I'm from Crawford School. Minister, I was particularly interested in your comment about political reform going hand in hand with economic reform in Mongolia. I look at Vietnam, for example, which started its economic reform about the same time as Mongolia, 1989, but political reform, it's lagging, and that is causing some problems now. You know, we end up with a marketized state. And it's even more curious in Mongolia because you have so much mineral wealth. The temptation for crony capitalism must be extremely high. How did you decide to go with political reform at the same time and resist the temptations?
Let's take that question and one more up here because it may be related.
Okay.
I'm just guessing.
I think you're right, Peter. Minister, I have had the pleasure of visiting your country. It occurred when I was representing Mongolia on the board of the World Bank. And I can confirm that the restaurant scene then, in the early days of your independence, was not good. I remember being taken to a dinner by finance ministry officials one evening. It consisted of five courses, all of them involving lamb.
Sounds like a friend.
with vodka generously provided in between each course. Anyway, my question is slightly related to Suiwa's. If you look at the league tables of institutional development and corruption, let's say Mongolia's position is not flattering. So I wonder why that is the case. Is it simply a matter of time that we have to be patient on these matters? Or is Mongolia not taking full advantage of the capacity building assistance that international institutions like the World Bank and others can provide?
Good. Well, you might like to come back, Minister Bol.
Yeah.
Both those questions.
Yeah, actually, it's very important issues we're raising. Because, the question to start. Political and economic reform at the same time, it was all about the timing, you know, to save time, to win time. But at the same time, it was about cost, you know. And having a strong rule and doing economic reform, it seems at some point you were also winning time, you know, because the decisions are made easier. But if you look back in many countries, you know, after achieving the economic development, then inevitably it leads to political reforms. Then you have the problems like Indonesia, Philippines, or also in future, you know, when it comes to the political reforms, what would be the cost in Vietnam or in China, especially? It's really, you can't imagine. In that case, I think our decision in the long term will really show that that was a very economically cost effective decisions. If you look, for example, in Kyrgyzstan, you know, where the most advanced demand is Central Asian Republic, but having every 5 years ousted president in the revolution, you know, it's you can't guarantee the economic costs, you know, and then its impact on the people. And also in some huge countries like Russia and China, of course, this is something up to you to calculate, you know. Mm-hmm. But in our part, I think we have done right, you know, and we have saved a lot of time and money with this. And of course, yes, we have mess, you know, it's sometimes, you know, that's inevitable, you know. And we like to have mess, you know, because then you learn, you know. Then you have something to repair, something to change, you know, and something to advance, you know. And it's any country is like a human being, you know. You grow, you know, and until you are mature age, you know, you go, you burn your fingers, and you have accident, everything, you know. But it should be a healthy person at the end, you know, and that's the important things. And of course, maybe we don't take the full advantage of the capacity buildings, but we learn that you never teach a child everything, you know. You can't make a total capacity building by any child, you know. It should be itself coming through it, you know, maturing itself. And I think that's in case also Mongolia. You know. Mongolia, if you look back the 20 years, last 20 years, you know, you can really see, you know, how this society has emerged as a healthy and strong and resistant to the crony capitalism and so on, anything, you know. That's I think, very important.
I think we have perhaps one time for one more question from the audience, but whilst I'm waiting for that to appear, I want to ask my question about Australian companies. Australia has built a big competitive resource industry. We have the cause of our trade with Northeast Asia and the investment from the rest of the world, some of the biggest and most competitive resource companies in the world based in Australia. And they, as you said, are actively interested in Mongolia for obvious reasons. How do they behave there? How do you manage them? And what's your lessons from, what lessons do you take away from dealing with Australian companies in your resource sector?
Yeah, I think generally the Australian companies are among the best. They are for best in attitude, best in practices, and best in their sincere cooperation endeavors with Mongolia. I think that, of course, there are issues with those big companies. They have their own strategies. And what we say is, don't consider Mongolia as compared just technically to other countries where they have their operations. You know. It is a different world, you know, which it doesn't mean it's exceptional, you know, but there should be really some understanding of Mongolia's situations and with which you really you cannot compare. You know. Where do you see a country in such magnitude and such richness and in such situation? Therefore, of course, some process maybe take a different time scale, but generally, I think we can find a very common language as Australian business.
More broadly, Minister, what are your ambitions for the relationship between Australia and Mongolia?
Yeah, we want Australia to really become our major third neighbour and make Mongolia, Australia like twin brothers, you know. And so, there's a with regards of the system and values and the economic development and understanding people to people. You know, it should be really an Asian example from Mongolia to Australia. It's like a model which would really encourage, you know, enlighten everyone, you know, to see how to some degree different countries but same conditions can benefit each other and complement each other and make a real sound model for many countries to follow. You know.
I'm afraid the Koreans will be very jealous.
Well, I think being on the edge in Asia implies in some way a sort of sense of anxiety. It also implies a sense of opportunity and challenge in the management of the huge changes that have taken place in our region. And Australia is in a position to share that with you and to deal with it, I hope, productively together with you. I hope that it's clear to all of you, as it is to me, that what comes through the Minister's presentation is a sense of boundless energy and perspective and constructivism in dealing with the opportunities and managing the challenges and suppressing the anxieties that may face Mongolia or anywhere else in the world. So thank you very much indeed for joining us. Before we close, the Minister has a very important letter of recognition to offer to the head of the Mongolian Study Centre here at the ANU.
Okay.
So this is the letter of recognition to Professor Li Narangwa, the chair of the Mongolia Institute. This is to acknowledge your contribution to the Mongolia studies in Australia. And this was awarded to Professor Narangwa and signed by Mongolian Minister for Education and Science, Mr. Kantumur, 2014, 21st of January. And I would like to invite Minister Ball to present the Professor Narangwa.
It's my pleasure. And congratulations.
Thank you very much.